only we hadn't gotten rid of all those mom and pop semiconductor chips.
Well, okay. So you mentioned artificial intelligence, Chris, and I want to just ask about this because I have this idea that the future of warfare is going to be a lot about artificial intelligence, whether it's like in guided missile technology or like things I can't imagine, like maybe kind of like a RoboCop scenario, but I...
Okay.
He was a policeman, not a military.
Yeah, I know, but like just, you know, what was the big scary one that shot everyone?
I forget.
You know what I'm talking about. It's like okay, so you've got this artificial intelligence that's being used for different types of military design and warfare. How is that related to the most advanced chips? And what are we going to start to see in terms of AI now that China is being largely cut off from the TSMC advanced chips?
So first off, if you think of what you need for AI to work, to kind of simplify, you need good algorithms, you need good data to train the algorithms on, and you need a lot of processing power, memory power to actually operate this. And I think it's pretty clear that China's got good algorithms and smart programmers that can write good algorithms. It's got plenty of data, although you want to ask what specific types of data do you need for specific use cases, but everyone's got data. It's processing power, memory power that is controlled by a small number of countries, and China's not one of them. And so that is the risk to China's rollout of AI across its economy and its military in particular. And if you think of use cases for AI in military systems, there's a number of different places it's already being used and will be used more in the future. You know, already you see it used in things like predictive maintenance, which I guess you'd expect. But going forward, as we get more and more autonomous systems, they will be making more and more decisions on their own, and doing so will require memory so that they are able to store lots of data on them. It'll require more processing power so they can think more rapidly and more effectively. And it'll require a lot of signals processing as well, taking in, for example, a lot of visual data, infrared data, data from LiDAR and sonar, and all that requires chips too. Whenever you convert a real-world signal like light or sound into data, you need a chip to do that. So if you imagine an advanced drone today, it needs to remember a lot of stuff. It needs to make decisions that are complicated and do so quickly. And it's got dozens of sensors on it, and that's a lot of semiconductors on a drone. And just to give you an example of the numbers, an anti-tank missile of the type, a shoulder-launched version of the type the U.S. is giving to Ukraine right now, called the Javelin, which was first pioneered several decades ago, has 200 semiconductors inside. And this is a missile that is simple, it's decades old, and it doesn't have a whole lot of complexity to it. It just finds the tank and hits it. If you're talking about drones that can take off on their own, fly on their own, identify targets on their own, think on their own, that's a whole lot more computing power and sensing power that they need, which is a whole lot more complicated semiconductors. And that's why both in the US and in China, military officials believe that chips hold the key to the future of military power, because that sensing, that thinking, that autonomous decision is going to be crucial for many types of military systems.
Anything in space will require more advanced semiconductors.
I mean, if only there were a way to train humans to fly aircraft.
I mean, but the aircraft they're flying is still going to need a lot of semiconductors.
Well, unless you go back to World War II.
Yeah, people aren't like plotting on maps where they are and stuff like that anymore.
I mean, the bomber planes in World War II would have engineers. You'd have a pilot in the front and engineers in the back who would be calculating the wind speed and the altitude and time the bomb drops, like by hand, right? I mean, now, like you just like that would be so far behind, like it would be almost useless.
Well, what I'm getting from chip war is just how fragile the semiconductor supply chain is already. And if anything, moving forward, will only become more dependent on this incredibly fragile system that can easily be disrupted.
I think that's right. That's the great promise, but also the great risk of semiconductors. On the one hand, we rely ever more on them. On the other hand, our reliance makes us vulnerable to disruption. And that's that's why I wrote ChipWar when I realized both the importance of chips, which I had sort of taken for granted, and the extent to which their production was so fragile, as you say, so controlled by a tiny number of firms.
Well, so what do you think is the solution to this? Because if anything has become clear over the past year is that we are not in a world where, you know, all the countries can work together with shared economic development. You know, there are still authoritarian regimes that will invade a country and just cause a lot of grief. Where does this go?
I think that's right. And that is the core geopolitical tension hanging over the chip industry, which was built over the past 30 years on the assumption that a globalized economy was here to stay and is now dealing with this bifurcation that you mentioned. You know, anyone looking at the entire world's reliance on Taiwan-produced chips, I think, comes to the conclusion that the security of Taiwan is crucially important. Even if you don't care about Taiwan for its own sake, you ought to care about it for the semiconductors that it produces and that you rely on. And I think that comes through pretty clearly by just a short glance at the graphs of who produces which chip. If you've ever used an iPhone, you've benefited from Taiwanese chip making. And that's something that no one else is going to replace anytime soon. And I think next to that, if you look at the steps that governments like the US, Europe, Japan are taking to try to diversify the footprint of where chips are made a little bit, those are the right steps to be taking. They're not going to dramatically reduce our reliance on Taiwan, but any sort of reduction, I think, is a smart move given just how concentrated chip making is in Taiwan and how dependent we all are on TSMC.
What do you think about the CHIPS Act?
So the key provision of the CHIPS Act is going to be to provide financial incentives for companies to build more advanced chip making facilities in the U.S. And that applies both to U.S. companies like Intel, but also to foreign companies like Samsung or TSMC is actually working on a new facility in Arizona, which will make some fairly advanced chips when it's online either next year or the year after. And I think this type of legislation makes sense. It's expensive. $50 billion is a lot of money to spend, but it's not a lot of money to spend when you think about the cost of what could go wrong in Taiwan. Now, that's a $1 trillion cost, if not several trillion dollars. And in comparison to that, the several billion we're spending on chips seems like a reasonable investment to me.
And do you think that the U.S. is going to continue to be fairly aggressive when it comes to trying to limit China's chip making abilities? I was kind of surprised when you said exactly what the Trump administration had done with Huawei. I didn't realize it had become I didn't realize the amount of leverage the U.S. really had in that sense. And do you think they're going to keep doing that?
Yeah, I think there is a bipartisan consensus in the U.S. that this policy is basically right. There's some debate around the margins, but the fact that it was started under Trump and continued under Biden, I think shows you that it's fairly durable. And my sense is that unless there's a big change in China's own ambitions and the money that China's putting into its own chip industry via programs like Made in China 2025, unless that changes, I don't think the U.S. policy is likely to change anytime soon either.
Yeah, this is all just incredible. Like the devastation this will have to the way of life that we know if the supply chain is broken, but also just like the entire future of humanity is dependent on the development of these semiconductors and these technology. AI, you know, everything involving space travel will be dependent on the continued advancement of semiconductors. A lot is at risk.
And yeah, a lot is at risk in terms of like very one small country.
Yeah.
In
under the crosshairs of a very evil authoritarian regime.
Yeah, so basically, Chris, we're all terrified now. So well,
I think we ought to be terrified. When I started this book 5 years ago, it was before the semiconductor shortages, before I really understood how important chips were. I thought it was just an interesting topic, cool technology, fascinating stories of businesses rising and falling. And I realized that this is the central risk that we all face, that modern society can't function without these chips, and they're produced on an island that is the center of geopolitical competition today. you know, that's why I called the book Chip War. It's I don't think an overestimation to say that this really is the central challenge or conflict of the modern day. And whether it is a war that stays cold or turns hot is the question on which the fate of not only advanced technology, but our economy and our society will turn.